and I'm pleased to welcome you to our afternoon keynote session in recognition of the late Dorothy Margaret Rose Knight, for whom this has been named. I'm honored to introduce our keynote speaker, Larry Kudlow. We're delighted to have him here with us today. Larry and I had a call last week in preparation for today's conference, and it was a terrific conversation. Larry brings such a wealth of knowledge and experience to his work and has such passion around his ideas. I hope that you'll have some good, challenging questions for him at the end. One thing he did ask, he said he really enjoys Q&A, so please come up with some good questions for Larry, and we'll leave some time for that. Many of you know Larry as a senior contributor to CNBC and a former host of the Kudlow Report. He's also the host of the Larry Kudlow Show, which is broadcast each Saturday on WABC Radio and is syndicated nationally. What is it here locally?
RKO.
WRKO.
So you can catch him. We're 179 cities. This started as a hobby. Now it's a business.
And you can catch him on his podcast if you can't catch him on Saturday mornings. He's a nationally syndicated columnist, a contributing editor of National Review Magazine, and a columnist and economics editor for the National Review Online, and the author of American Abundance, The New Economic and Moral Prosperity. During President Ronald Reagan's first term, Larry was the Associate Director for Economics and Planning under the Office of Management and Budget in the Executive Office of the President, where he was engaged in the development of the administration's economic and budget policy. He's been the recipient of numerous community service awards. He's on the board of directors of Hazelden, New York, Mountainside Treatment Center, and Catholic Cluster School in the Diocese of Bridgeport, Connecticut. He's a former Fordham University Board of Trustees member. He's the CEO of Kudlow and Company, an economic research firm. In his early career, he was the chief economist and senior managing director of Bear Stearns. He started his professional career at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, where he worked in the open market operations and in bank supervision. He was educated at the University of Rochester and Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. He earned a PhD in economics from the University of Chicago and an AB in mathematics from Princeton. So with that, I give you Larry Kudlow.
So, I'm like a good church-going parish council, get them into the pews, comma, free market capitalist. So I begin with a contradiction right away. I love the church. God knows I think the church has saved my life. But we have our disagreements about abundance, prosperity, markets, things of that sort. Just to give you a little background, which we don't have in the official biography. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. And I walk through some big picture topics. And I have a couple of numbers to share because I have a few hobby horses to ride, as you might guess. So at the beginning, let me just say this. Economically, the United States is not heading for Armageddon. I just don't buy it. In fact, in my professional lifetime, I've seen worse. I've seen much worse. And probably a lot of you have too. There's no Armageddon. You know, having said that, there's no great growth. I guess the best way to put it is there's no boom, there's no bust. There's no recession. There's no inflation. There's no risk-taking. There's hardly any business investment going on. So it's a mixed and, I think, on the whole, disappointing story in the sense that, as you know, and we and I know, professionally, we have done better and we can do better. It's never perfect, and we have our ups and downs. Capitalism is like that. But I'm just saying that you kind of have to keep your powder dry. I don't like the Armageddon crowd at all. I'm a congenital optimist. Always have been, always try to be. A lot of that comes from my own personal life. A lot of that comes from my economic analysis. America is the greatest economy in the world. It still is. And hopefully it will remain so for a good long time. But we have our ups and downs. What we need now, before I get into some specifics, is sort of two things I think that are really missing from this picture. One is optimism. Now, I can't quantify that. I mean, we could look at consumer surveys and whatnot. You could look at the stock market for that matter, but we don't have enough. People are in a bad mood, you know? Now, one of the reasons I want to take your questions later is because I don't get out much. I tend to live in a bit of a bubble. But when I do get out, I mean, I hear it and I read. They're in a bad mood. They look for the worst. They look for the worst. And we need somebody to change that. That's a leadership function. That's a political and an economic issue. You know, maybe we can talk a bit about that later on at the end. The other thing is people need to start taking risks again. It's astonishing to me, and this is, I'm not here to blame everything on Barack Obama. I don't agree with his policies for the most part, although I do on this trade bill, very much so. But I'm just saying, after the meltdown of 2008, people have avoided risk. You see it everywhere. And I don't know how you change this. I mean, it takes a while. You know, I grew up as a kid in the Reagan administration. I was one of the budget deputies. And I spent a fair amount of time with him the first couple years when he was working on his economic reforms. And he was a guy who really encouraged business and small business to take a rip at the ball, you know? He used to say that. He loved the sports analogies, and he basically said to him, I got your back. I got your back. I'm going to give you some tax cuts. I'm going to give you some regulatory relief. I'm going to have to make some deals you may not totally agree with, but I'm going to make them. And he basically said, I want you to go out and go for it. We don't have that today. We just don't. We have an administration that basically is telling you you're too big, too fat, too overweight, and you get paid too much. All right? And I don't like that. I don't like that one bit. Even if it's true, I don't like it. It's my biggest objection. I've said this to the president. I mean, I've said to him, he's very congenial, he's a brilliant guy. You know, if this presidential race revolves around that kind of rhetoric, the people that talk about it are going to suffer. They're going to suffer. America is about business. I don't want to sound like Calvin Coolidge, but I do like Calvin Coolidge. We're big. We're shopkeepers. We're Main Street business. But you know what? We're also large businesses. We're multinational businesses, do a lot of money, do a lot of trading overseas. We shouldn't be penalized for that. We're banks. How much can you bash banks? Would you tell me that? Are you tired of bank bashing? I mean, I don't know. I know bankers who have lovely families, who are sort of middle to upper middle class people, who would have trouble paying what I heard at lunch, $60,000 to go to Boston College. Great school that you are. Bankers, they're bankers. They're not all guys, you know, you look at the CEOs, the top couple of hundred companies in the S&P and make a lot of money. You look at the rest of the country, they do not. They do not. And were mistakes made? Of course they were. Risk management mistakes were made. Government mistakes were made. It's enough already. I mean, I come from New York. You're in Massachusetts. You used to be a really blue state. Not so much anymore. Not so much. New York, I got a governor and an attorney general and a bank superintendent who are building bank fines into the annual budget. No, whatever. If you can't find it, you look for it and get it. This isn't right. So I'm not here to make an unmitigated defense of banks. I'm just saying enough already. Enough already. We need to grow the economy and create jobs. Now, couple of specifics here. I'm a great believer in a strong dollar. Down through the years, you show me periods like the 60s and the 80s and the 90s where the dollar was strong, and I'm going to show you a flourishing, prosperous economy. You show me periods when the dollar was slumping, crashing, and whatever, like the 70s. And the 2000s, and I'll show you a lousy economy. All right? Biggest mistake my friend George W. Bush made, he's a very dear personal friend of mine, but the dollar fell 45% on his watch, and that was bad. Neutralized anything good he did, tax cuts and so forth, all that was neutralized. Money was flowing out of America. Right now, under the Obama administration, the Federal Reserve policy, whether I don't really think it's what they're aiming for, but it so happens the dollar is rising, and that's a good thing in my humble opinion, and is the flip side of the fall in oil prices. Really the trigger. You know, everything's priced in dollars globally, and when the dollar goes up, commodities go down, plus you have the great fracking revolution, which really created the increase in supply. All it needed was a little trigger, and the dollar gave it to him. Now, one of the points I want to raise this afternoon is this. They are good things, quite apart from politics. A strong dollar and a low oil price are good things. In fact, there are two tax cuts, unlegislated economic tax cuts. I have spent the better part of the last 12 months as a commentator on CNBC. I retired from the nighttime show after 15 years, but so I'm on a couple times a week, and all I'm doing is arguing with investors and anchors and friends of mine and all the rest of it. The dollar is really bad, and the oil prices drop is really bad. And I'm like scratching my head because I grew up in the last century, in the 1970s. I was at the New York Fed, and then I was at on Wall Street for term. And we had a low dollar and high oil prices. Remember that? How was that economy? Seriously, do you remember that? How was that? How'd that do for you? Or let me go back again. I got to be nonpartisan here. During the Bush years in the 2000s, the dollar fell, as I said, by 40-45%. The price of gold went from about $250 an ounce to $800 an ounce. And the price of oil, you know, we forget this. Oil prices in, let me see if I get my dates right, 06, but particularly 07 and 08, for a variety of reasons, oil went from about, I don't know, $50 a barrel to $150 a barrel. That wouldn't happen if the dollar was strong. That wouldn't happen if we had decent energy prices, which I must say, for a Texas oil man, President Bush did not. He disappointed me. And how did that work out for you, that 2000s period? Good or not good? Now, here we are in the 2010s, and again, I happen to disagree with most of what President Obama is doing, but I got to tell you, it's the stuff that he didn't do that's doing great. It's the fracking revolution. He had no idea, never saw it coming. He's basically opposed to fossil fuels. You know, he wants to do this for solar, electric, windmills and God knows what else, I'm okay with that as long as I don't have to pay for it as a taxpayer and subsidize the corruption. Other than that, you want to build a windmill? Be my guest. I have no problem with it. You want to build an electric car? Elon Musk, I've interviewed him many times. Fine. But the reality is we are now producing 9.5 million barrels a day of oil. Boom. And we have been outproducing the rest of the world natural gas. Boom. You think that's good or bad? Serious question. I get debates, people yelling at me, it's bad for exports, it's bad for earnings. You know, in the afternoon I do an hour with Kelly Evans, and we get our earnings reports, and a lot of these multinational companies are blaming their shortfall in earnings, if it happens, on the strong dollar. I go, what? First of all, let's just break this down. Worth a second, okay? None of these companies should worry about currency translation because they don't bring the money home. You're the experts. You tell me. You know a lot of corporations now that are going from low-tax Europe and Asia to high-tax America? Because what I gather is about $2 trillion overseas. They do a lot of business. They have sales offices and they have, you know, manufacturing and so forth. But it's a lot to do with taxes. Right? They don't even bring that money home. So why am I worrying about currency translation? I know you have to report it on a GAAP accounting basis. It means absolutely nothing. The reason our exports are sluggish is because the rest of the world's in a recession. That's why. And by the way, our strong dollar will actually help them because we're going to import more goods from them, help get them out of recession because they can't do it alone. They don't know how to cut taxes. They don't know how to lower spending. They don't know how to deregulate. So we'll buy their goods. Because they're a little cheaper. Somebody out there make a decent t-shirt and a pair of sneakers, somebody will buy it. That's good. So the dollar on the whole is a good thing Good thing. The other one is oil. What did I hear? When oil starts falling, it's going to destroy all the oil companies, going to decimate the energy sector, which has been a great performing sector, decimate. Now, I know that CapEx is down in energy. I get that. They move very fast. I'm going to come back to that in a minute, my fracking 2.0 argument. Rig count is down. That's what happens. Now, mind you, it went up for the prior 5 or 6 years. It wasn't really price sensitive. When the fracking revolution really started, it was 2005. It wasn't about oil prices. It was about technology. Now, are you going to really tell me, CEOs, CFOs, money, are you going to tell me that energy prices down 50% isn't a good thing? I mean, outside of a handful of core energy companies, which is probably time to buy, you just tell me it's good. It's not a good thing? Of course it's a good thing. Of course it's a good thing. And it takes 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 months to sink in. That's the way it works. We're going to see, you know, we got consumer real income is rising. Even business profits in the whole are doing pretty well outside energy. It's going to have a very positive impact on the economy. And in fact, just bear with me. I'll give you some, see if I got all my numbers here. In the last year, okay, here, the last year, 12 months, right? Energy off 50%. The dollar up 20%. The two evils. The two evils. Wrecked the economy. So I look at the 12-month changes. The S&P is up 10%. The Russell 2000 is up 12%. The NASDAQ is up 20%. These are during the periods of the twin evils of a rising dollar and falling energy prices, which are supposed to destroy the economy. I don't know. Doesn't look bad to me. My wife and I own all these index funds. We're just happy as clams. I don't have that much time to go, so this is, you know, this is good. Other stuff, okay, the inflation rate is flat. Is that a bad thing? You know, when I grew up in the 70s, the inflation rate got to 15% twice. And the entire thrust of American economic policy changed under Paul Volcker and Alan Greenspan. Volcker, I was his secretary, believe it or not, at the New York Fed many, many, many years ago. We are still friends to this day. The idea was low inflation created higher growth. In other words, take your nominal GDP, say you got 4% nominal GDP. It's been the average for the past 6 years. QE hadn't done a thing to that. So if you're 2 and 2, 2% real, 2% inflation, and now you go down to 1% inflation or less, the consumer price deflator came out, what, yesterday, day before yesterday? 0.1% last 12 months. So if the inflation rate goes down in the same mix, the real output rate's going up. That's good. That's what we want. Nowadays, the Federal Reserve Board is telling us we need higher inflation to stimulate the economy. This I don't get. And I totally, utterly disagree. I love Ben Bernanke. Ben was the first Republican, probably in the history of Princeton University, where I won for a spell, to be the chairman of the economics department, or probably any other department. I don't know if you have that problem here at BC. We'll talk later. But I'm just saying, he's a good man. He's a smart guy. I just don't accept that view, that higher inflation is a good thing. Janet Yellen says the same thing. I don't agree. I don't agree. Now, I don't think they're inflationistas. They don't want to go back to 10. But, you know, it's a tricky business. I watched it happen as a kid. So did you. You know, you aim for 2 or 3, you get 5. All right? You say we're going to stop it out of 5, but you don't, you get 8, and then you go to 12. I've seen this movie. I don't want to repeat it. So the inflation rate is flat. The year-on-year economy, four-quarter change in real GDP during this period of collapsing energy and rising dollar, is 2.7%. All right? It ain't great. You know, the average for this recovery is just over 2. I'll talk more about that in a second. But I'm just saying, over the year where energy prices fell substantially, and it really cut back on CapEx because of the oil and the rising dollar, the stock markets are up 10, 12, 20%. The inflation rate is 0. The economy is growing at 2.7%. I've seen worse, kids. I've seen worse. Right. And the other thing I'll say is profits, which have been slammed in energy, I get that. Nonetheless, the best measure of profits, it's one of my leading indicators of the economy, GDP profits, national income and product account profits, which are akin to IRS profits, so you won't lie, cheat, or steal. And pre-tax profits are up 5%, and core domestic profits, non-financial domestic profits, are up 7.5%. This is in the last year. Pretty good. Pretty good. You're not going to get 15% profits every year. That's for the beginning of the cycle. And profits as a share of GDP are near all-time record highs. So all this stuff happened as the dollar went up and oil prices went down. Everybody told me what a catastrophe. I don't see this catastrophe. I'm objective here. That's nothing to do with politics, nothing to do with the election. I'm just saying here are the goddamn numbers. Explain to me why these are disastrous outcomes. I'm sorry, I shouldn't say that in a Catholic school. I take it back. God help me. All right, couple of other points. This is the anti-recession argument I'm making. The two things that have preceded all the post-war recessions, all of them, is an inverted yield curve, right? Short rates higher than long rates, which signify Fed tightening, and spiking oil prices. We've had neither. The curve is positively sloped, actually moving higher now recently. I think your 10-year treasury is 2.25, 2.30, and the T-bills is zero. That's the New York Fed model. But they're right. I mean, you've got to have every recession has been preceded by an inverted curve, including 2007, 2008 period. It's not happened. It's not happened yet. And my reading is it's not going to happen for at least several more years. No recession. For a million reasons, but that's one of them. The Federal Reserve is going to correctly attempt to normalize interest rates. You can't have a zero interest rate forever, all right? That's banana republic stuff. That's for Argentina. This is America. So we can't have a zero rate forever. Some places in Europe have negative rates. Now, my hunch is, just a hunch, you guys know more about it probably than I do, but Ms. Yellen and the Federal Reserve Board, the FOMC, will probably move rates up roughly the pace of an injured snail. That's my forecast. Okay, you ever seen an injured snail? All right, worse than the New York Yankees rounding second base, believe me. I actually think they're probably wise to go very slowly because, again, you've got a strong dollar and low commodity prices. Those are inflation indicators, and they don't need to rush it. They need to do what they need to do. The John Taylor rule would have the Fed funds target rate, which probably won't be really used. They'll probably use their excess bank reserves rate. But in any event, he's got a 1.5% on the Taylor rule. John's a real smart guy and a good friend. And I figure in the next 12 months, you might get to 1.5%, which would still leave money highly accommodative, will not have any impact on inflation. And stock markets will zig and zag, but on the whole has no net effect. What matters for stocks is profits, the mother's milk of stocks, not a slight, small Fed funds rate increase. It's not going to have any impact. Bonds might sell off some. You know, I prefer stocks, okay? I prefer stocks to bonds. Janet Yellen said stocks are pricey. What did she say, overvalued? It's not good for Fed chairman. It goes back to Greenspan's irrational exuberance. You don't, it's not part of their job description to predict the stock market, biotech, what else did she say? I can't remember. I went in one ear and out the other. Stocks are doing fine. It's bonds you got to watch out for. I mean, if your retirement funds have bonds, you should ladder them up. You don't want to just go for the long-term bond. Those days are over. So easy, slight, tiny Fed incremental rate increases. The other stuff never worked in the first place, quantitative easing, monetarism. I was trained as a monetarist, okay? Milton Friedman, it didn't work. If monetarism had worked with a $4.5 trillion balance sheet, and if the multipliers into M2 and the velocity of M2 through the economy worked, the inflation rate today would be somewhere between 15 and 20%. none of it really worked. So that's too bad. That's an experiment gone awry. We could talk about that some more if you want. But the other thing is, Fed's not going to invert the curve, and oil prices are not going up. Now, when I say not going up, they can go to 70, they can go to 40. I'm saying they're not going to 100, they're not going to 150. And let me just say a word about oil prices, and then I want to do some political economy with you, and then we'll stop. I recommend to you some very good articles on the fracking revolution, what they're calling fracking 2.0. One by Mark Mills of the Manhattan Institute in Manhattan, excellent think tank, free market think tank, and the other one by Mark Perry from the University of Michigan, but a scholar at the American Enterprise Institute in Washington. So they're arguing, it's very interesting, I love this, it just makes so much sense to me, and no one wants to talk about it, so I know it has some value added. What we're seeing now is the end of the first phase, which they call fracking 1.0. And fracking 1.0 was the, I won't say the discovery, because this stuff had been around for a long time, but the application of a breakthrough, a very Schumpeterian, gales of creative destruction, application of technologies that were out there but no one used. You know, this fellow Mitchell from Texas, nobody listened to him forever, until he finally got some people to listen. The Barnett Shale underneath Dallas-Fort Worth, and it was fabulous, and then it spread like wildfire. The best way to think about fracking, you know, horizontal drilling and the actual rock fracking, is these are technological breakthroughs that happen to be in the energy patch. You follow me? They could have been in software, they could have been in clouds, they could have been in Apple wristwatches. They could have been in, you know, my iPhone 6 Plus. They just happened to be in the energy business. Now, why that's important is, what happens with gales of creative destruction? What happens with technological breakthroughs and applications? In every single field we've seen in the last 3-4 decades, the technology gets better, and the cost comes down. That's the key. The cost comes. That's why this isn't going away. I don't care what the Saudis, the Saudis forgot, they didn't do fracking. Missed the whole boat on this. And now it's gotten completely out of hand. They've lost control. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. And these prices are gonna stay down. Now, what I love about it from almost day one is we are completely screwing Russia. God, I love that. Right, you know, add to that, to the third power, Iran, another great friend of the United States, and a few others, Venezuela, you know, some little ankle biters here and there. So this is good. I mean, I like this story a lot, but I mainly like it a lot, you know, because it'll do good in America and the world economy. So these guys, Mark Mills and Mark Perry, are saying, you wait, the break-even cost of producing fracking oil profitably in Eagle Ford can, in the next couple of years, go to $20 a barrel. All right? That may not be right. That's just their view. In fact, Mr. Mills gives it a range of $5 to $20 a barrel. I think Mark Perry's a little higher than that. When I talked to Harold Hamm, my very dear friend, I used to have him on the show all the time. Nobody listened to the guy, when some North Dakota cowboy, whatever. I said, hey, Harold, come on the show and tell me about your fracking revolution, which is, by the way, changing the world. Now, he would never state, even in private telephone calls, what his break-even is. All right? I understand he's a publicly held company, but he can do good business at 60. He can still do good business at 50. And when you get to the pure wellhead price, not the transportation, but the wellhead price, he's going to be down to 25 or 30. And as I said, I actually saw the Ford Eagle thing in Texas. They're actually increasing slightly the rig count, just slightly going up again, which reacts to the little bump up in oil prices, which is probably nothing more than short covering. But these guys move fast. their, you know, investment moves fast, and their layoffs move fast, and their hirings move fast, and their production moves fast. So it's here to stay, and I'm just telling you, this is great. This is great. And don't underestimate it. I don't care what. The people who come on CNBC are smart, brilliant, credentialed. I love them to death. They all came on my show. They're still coming on my radio show, and they are wrong. They're just dead wrong about this energy story, and they're even worse wrong about the dollar. So that's my point of view, and you don't buy it, I'm okay with that. I'm just saying, I'm putting it out. That's one of the reasons why we're going to survive this stuff. Now, a couple last things, and I want to take your questions. So there's a timer clock here or something? They were yelling me out. I can't even see that far. What bothers me about the world big picture, now I know you've heard from my friend Neil Ferguson and others today. Neil's a genius, if you ask me, and a good friend, and a frequent guest. But look, I am more worried about America's foreign international military situation, much more worried than I am about the economy. You know, I go back to my Reagan experience. It was a whole lot easier in fixing the economy than it was to fix Soviet communism and their march for world supremacy. Much easier for the economy. In fact, if I get a few of you who are rather sensible, Reagan, Kemp, Laffer, Kudlow, free market supply side types, which is the only really thing that matters in economics today. That was a joke, it's okay. But if I sit down with you and talk about economic planning, I can fix the economy in 25 minutes. Whether it goes through Congress or not, I can fix the economy in 25 minutes, at least on paper. I can't do that in foreign policy. 2 days ago, I heard General Petraeus. He spoke at our Police Athletic Association monthly lunch of businessmen. He didn't quite say it, but he inferred quite clearly that we're doing everything wrong in the Middle East. And what was his term? We're slipping behind. General Jack Keane, who is a good friend, I think the best strategic thinker we have in this country, has argued in front of the Senate Armed Services Committee, much less my little radio show on Saturday, that we are losing in the Middle East. We are losing. Okay, I don't like that for 100 reasons. But I know this. As a New Yorker, look, you've had it in Boston. We've all had it. You give them, the bad guys, whatever their name is, you give them chunks of real estate to sit around and have nightly meetings, they are planning to come after us. Please make no mistake about that. We are the end game. The foreplay is the Middle East. I get that. They'd like to take over hegemonically. Iran, in particular, is the biggest sponsor of state terrorism. Me, personally, I wouldn't make a deal with them for 3 bushels of bananas. Maybe the president has better information, but a whole lot of people think he doesn't. ISIS, you know, Petraeus himself said in an interview in the Washington Post, I wrote a column about it in some detail with some follow-up, Petraeus himself said Iran is a bigger threat than ISIS because of its hegemonic ambitions and because of its power. I'm not going to go heavy into foreign policy. It's not my mission for this talk. But I believe that's the big problem we face. Now, on the economy, the first thing I would do is slash the corporate tax. The absolute first thing I would do. It's killing us for a lot of reasons. First of all, the rate is too high at 35 to 40. Everybody else is in the low 20s. I'll give Europe credit. Europe brought its rate down. I think Britain is at 20, Canada's at 15, and we're at 35 to 40. So we should get our corporate tax rate down to about 20%, fix this double tax of overseas profits, make it a territorial system, not a worldwide system. Don't double tax their profits, and that will induce them to really bring a lot of money home, I think. I don't know what the number is. These estimates vary, but if it's true you got $2 trillion of cash overseas, if not a half, at least a third of that's going to come back to the United States, and it's going to be put to work someplace. And we need full cash expensing for the building of new plants and equipment. Full cash expensing. You know, it's a great story. One night, Fred Smith of FedEx, who, I don't know, maybe you've had him up here, he's a wonderful, brilliant businessman and a friend of mine and frequent guest on the Cutler Report. And one night I had him on, this was several years ago, talking about corporate tax reform. And it was probably the 2012 election cycle. And he said to me, the most important thing you can do is give companies full cash expensing, immediate write-offs, instead of waiting 5, 7, 10 years and God knows what inflation and interest rates are gonna do and other expenses, full cash. And I hadn't really heard that, so and I'm taking notes on, he's telling me and I'm taking notes on the air. It's usually the reverse, but that's okay. I learned a lot. So tax rates, territorial and full cash expensing would do so much to put a boost into this economy. And by the way, it's not just the big companies. It's the little companies who are, they're playing overseas now too. So they got to figure out a way to get the pass-throughs, the S-Corps and the LLCs, they got to get that lower rates and those improvements also. And these raise very delicate political questions. We actually are not totally apart in Washington. If you talk to Paul Ryan, who runs the Ways and Means Committee, probably the smartest guy in the House or one of them, he's talking to presidents, people in Treasury, but the whole what's holding everything up is the small business part, because the president doesn't want to reduce any personal tax rates. So I don't know if that's dead or not this year. If it's dead this year, then it'll be dead, you know, until 2017. But that's the very first thing I do. I'd throttle back on regulations. I think we've gone way, way too far. I mentioned banks at the beginning. Banks are afraid to make a loan. I don't care whether you're J.P. Morgan or the local, you know, First Trust and Bank Company in Southwest Missouri. They're afraid to make loans. Loans have picked up a little bit, but they're still way below the levels they were. And, you know, I think that's over-regulation. I'm completely opposed to Obamacare, which I think is a job killer. It has all the wrong incentives for growth and jobs. I'm all for health care reform. And you know what? I might even be for a mandate that everyone has health care. I might be for that, as long as there's full-fledged 100% choice in the choosing of a health plan, not these regulations and one size fits all, and you can go across borders to do it. Look, I'm a 60-something guy, right? I don't need lactation services. All right? But you may. Or your brides may. You see what I'm saying? So you go on ahead and do it, and let me go. There's other stuff that I need that you don't need, right? I mean, I got an epidural back injection yesterday. I can hardly stand up. I got to fly to Boston. I mean, can I be covered for that? Well, it's part of the way. But I'm saying the issue is I'm not making fun of lactation services or mammograms. It's very important. I'm just saying let the people who need that go out and get a plan that has it, and let the people that don't need it get a different plan. All right? Don't regulate the prices. Give the market a chance. I'm a free market guy. I'm a choice guy. Don't tell me about, you know, you can't go above 49 workers without incurring an expensive business mandate. You can't go above, 29 hours worked per week? That's crazy. It's holding back jobs. Here's the other thing on Obamacare that you get these subsidies, and they're going to be subsidies. I'm not against the safety net. They're going to always be. The Republican plans have tax credits and subsidies too, although they're not near as generous. But the point I'm making is, if you go into the workforce and you're starting at the bottom, and you're around $16,000, $18,000, $20,000 a year, you qualify for health care plan subsidies. I'm not against that. Take a tax credit. But if you get better and move up the ladder, you get to 25, 26, you lose the subsidy. That's an incentive not to work. And it's the same thing across the board. We had great welfare reform. bipartisan welfare reform in the 1990s with Clinton and Gingrich and so forth. And they made wonderful changes, and a lot of people said this is going to destroy people and the unemployment rate is going to rise. And wrong. When you put some eligibility requirements in, some time requirements in, some training opportunities, they went back to work. You know, Arthur Brooks, the president of American Enterprise Institute, always puts it best. I love Arthur. I've interviewed him. People who have what he calls earned income, you're working and you get an income, are, according to all the surveys, happier than people who have welfare-related income, unearned income. Happier. This is what the data says. So we got to reconstruct the system. We've got to bring back reforms in welfare, food stamps, disability insurance. There's a lot of them. You want to increase the earned income tax credit for low-income people? I'm okay with that. We're going to have to change. It's a rather fraudulent system, but it can be done. Minimum wage, absolutely wrong. I'm completely opposed to the minimum wage. Who's going to pay for this? Consumers are going to pay for this. It's not free. I watched my distinguished mayor of New York on CNBC yesterday. He wants to go to 15%. There's only, first of all, about 4 or 5% of the workforce that would qualify. Second of all, he's going to utterly damage youngsters and untrained and minorities who will be, you know, priced out of the market. I mean, he really lived up. The guy, I love him. He's really a true Sandinista Democrat. You know, he worked in Nicaragua for the Ortega brothers, and that was a long time ago, and he hadn't changed a bit. It's just fantastic. He and his wife were married on an illegal visa in Cuba. All the chickens have come home to roost. So I want to make these changes in entitlements. I want to make these changes. I want it to pay to work. And I want you to have a good after-tax investment return on your work and investment and risk-taking. That's what I want to restore. And I'd like to throttle back the regulations. I'm not against all regulations. I'd like to throttle them back. I don't want to say to people, you didn't build that business. I don't. I want people to have an attitude in Washington of encouraging risk, of encouraging startup. Our startups, by the way, you ever look at business startups, it's the biggest form of job creation. Not small business, but brand new startups have fallen off a cliff in the past 15 some odd years. So I want people to have incentives to do that. I believe in the incentive model. I want a strong dollar. I want to help the frackers, not hurt them. And like I say, just sit down with the right people, I'll fix the economy in 25 minutes. We need to get back to our long-term growth measures. My last point. This is a great issue in this election. And so far, I'm not altogether happy with the Republicans either on this. The economy in the long run, as you may know, since World War II, has grown at just shy of 3.5% a year. In fact, actually, I did some... From the last century, from 1900 to 2000, the economy grew just shy of 3.5% a year. It's interesting, in real terms. That is the greatest, longest, continuous prosperity of any country in the history of history. Some people have done it for 10 years, 20 years. No one's ever done it. We've actually done it for close to 200 years. We've had booms, we've had busts, but on balance, that's an awesome growth rate. We've grown at 2% annually for the last 15 years under Democrats and Republicans. That's wrong. And the job numbers, you know, the unemployment rate may be 5.4%, but that's because so many people have dropped out of the labor force, some of the reasons I gave you earlier. The U6 is a better measure of this, discouraged workers and dropouts. That's 10.8% in the sixth year of recovery, which is not good. Not good. So we need incentives to improve that. We need sound money and lower energy prices. All this stuff can be fixed. It all can be fixed. And is it going to get fixed? Yeah, I think it will. You know why I think it will? Because, shall I say, the people inside our great democracy want a change. They've had it up to here. And you know what? You look at those numbers carefully. Wrong direction, right direction. This is not a partisan issue. I admit more Republicans will line up on the wrong direction, but a lot, half the Democrats will too. not really a partisan issue. People, as I said at the beginning, are unhappy campers. By the way, I'm writing a book. It'll be out very early next year on the John F. Kennedy economic policies, particularly his tax cuts. But he was a free trader. He kept the dollar linked to gold, and he launched one of the greatest expansions in history for 10 years. So I'm probably a JFK Democrat, whatever I am. And by the way, Reagan used to say all the time, he voted four times for FDR and once for Harry Truman. So maybe it takes one to know one and then change it. That's the deal. One reporter once asked Reagan, do you bear any blame for what's happened down through the years in the country? And he said, yeah, for several decades I was a registered Democrat. Oh, that made it so partisan. I'm so sorry. Look, I'm Kudlow. You know who I am. I hope I've helped you a little bit today. I love coming up to BC. I've never been here before. It's absolutely fabulous. And the hosts at lunch and on the phone have been wonderful. And I thank you for that. You've been a great audience. And I will open the floor for as many questions as you want.
Larry, in the ever-expanding group of Republican presidential hopefuls, who are the one or two or three that you see perhaps emerging in the end, and what do you think the chances are of the Republicans regaining the White House in the 2016 election?
Pretty good. On your last one, pretty good. I wouldn't underrate or denigrate Mrs. Clinton, but I think pretty good. Probably because of the change factor, it's time for change. And she's run a lousy campaign so far, but I don't want to underestimate her because I don't know her. I know her husband rather well, who I thought was a brilliant politician and not a bad policymaker. She's to the left of Bill Clinton, but we'll see about the final. You know, the GOP race, I'm very involved in this, oddly, much more than I thought I would be. Maybe it's because I've been around so long, but I know most of these people, and I know them on a first-name basis, and I've actually been to visit with them and had, you know, multi-hour sit-downs. And we formed a little group in New York, Steve Forbes and Art Laffer and I and Steve Moore, called the Committee to relaunch Prosperity. And we brought these candidates in to a dinner of maybe 40 or 50 people, just try to beat the living daylights out of them until they get the economic story right. We've had good people. We've had Walker, Perry, Carly, Fiorina. I missed last night was Lindsey Graham because I have my back. We had Ted Cruz earlier in the week. So we're going to get them all. Jeb will come down and Rubio will come down. So we're working on it. But they got to have a growth message, a real clear growth message, much of which I've given you this afternoon. It's going to revolve around those principles, incentives, freedom, free trade. I didn't mention free trade as much as I should have. That's pro-growth. That will help. The race itself has no bearing on the stock market right now. It's way too far in the future. The free trade bill would be very positive for stocks because pro-growth. Anytime you lower tariffs, you're lowering taxes, which is good for both sides. A win-win. I thoroughly back the president on that one. And, I want lower I want flatter, lower tax rates and the deductions as much as possible. Get out of the crony capitalism business, Republicans. Fix the corporate income tax. Keep the dollar sound. Simple stuff. So who's the guy? I don't know. It's just too hard right now. I know it's in the newspapers every day. Rick Perry is announcing today. Jeb said he's going to put it up June 15th. We've had a half a dozen or more. You know what? I'm going to dodge the whole answer. You know why? It's funny. I'm a big tweeter. I tweet a lot, and I was tweeting last night that Governor Perry was going to make his announcement today. And Rick Perry and I are longtime friends. I think he's a great man. He had lousy 2012, but I think he's a terrific governor and a good military man, captain in the Air Force. But I said to my followers, go back and look at the last week or so. I've had positive things to say about a bunch of them. Jeb Bush came out for a strong dollar 2 days ago. Did you see that? Oh, just than sex. I mean, it's just fabulous. Because his brother presided over the collapse of the dollar. And in a mini way, so did his father. The strong dollar guys were Reagan and Clinton and Rubin. And you had good success under that. So I've had nice Jim Jeb, and Walker said some good things. He may have the strongest political backbone in America after what they've thrown at him. Wins three statewide elections in a blue state, you know, Wisconsin. Ever been around Madison, Wisconsin makes Boston College look like, I don't know, Friedrich Hayek or something. And believe me, you got to go to Madison to really experience the vibes. So this guy keeps winning. He's a conservative Republican, but he has a good message. John Kasich's a good, smart guy, been a great governor of Ohio. So there's a bunch of them. Let the games begin, you know? First debate is August 9th. And the debates are going to be very important, as they were. Let the games begin. I don't really feel like taking a position on that. Yes, sir.
Oh, hoping yeah. You can help me think through at least one of the ramifications of fracking 2.0. So Houston, as we all know, has had a higher than average job growth for the last several years up until fourth quarter, and has experienced pretty significant job cuts calendar 15. A lot of people in local economy are sort of extrapolating that, you know, fears being what they are. But by virtue of the break-even price dropping perhaps the low 20s and volumes spiking, can you see a scenario where there's Houston 3.0, where Houston becomes a boomtown again because Houston lives off volume production and marginal profits and not necessarily off the nominal price?
Well, you know, it's really part of their 2.0 outlook, because they're arguing that you have your initial layoffs as the price adjustment occurs, but with the tech advances and the cost declines, you're going to see rebounds. You may be on and off, just like any of these tech businesses. You know, some of these companies have great product cycles, and then they don't, and they do. Some of them get gobbled up. The interesting thing about Texas, and I know this because I've talked to Rick Perry a lot about this, their economy is very free and open. It's one of the least taxed, regulated states in the country. And it's a good model, in my opinion. He's got a tech boom going on in the Austin area, which is phenomenal. And he's got some Silicon Valley companies moving there because he doesn't have a corporate income tax. He doesn't even have personal income tax. And a lot of them prefer that to what's going on in California. He's also got education boom, healthcare boom. Texas, unbelievable center now. A lot of it's in Houston, but some of it's in Dallas, some of it's in San Antonio. I just gave a talk down in San Antonio, and they're building huge hospitals. My friend David Koch of New York, you know, was known as a conservative political contributor. He's actually one of the greatest philanthropists in America, and he's given up $1.3 billion away to various hospitals and related medical facilities. He's a cancer survivor. That has something to do with it. So you're seeing that. Texas got that. He was kidding me. He says, you know, you're down here from New York. My wife is an artist, pretty good painter. And they've got art galleries. They've got symphonies. They've got opera going down there. In other words, they got activity outside of 10-gallon hat, wildcatter, whatever they're called. There's more to it than that. Now, that doesn't mean they're not going to have some pain. I can agree with you. But, geez, I don't know. It's a pretty diverse kind. All these states, you know, you look at, I mean, I'm going to sound partisan here, but I'm just going to argue the free market, low tax states do better. They just do. The data is so clear. Now, you're going to argue with me? Okay. I do that for a living. I'm all right with it. But I'm just saying, you look at some of these states, like North Carolina is coming out of the blue. My friend Steve Moore wrote a great op-ed in the Journal today about Carolina. People say, well, in Kansas, Sam Brownback's tax cuts, they didn't kick in immediately. It was phased out, so it wasn't the supply side miracle overnight, but they're working very, very well. In Michigan, they've cut tax rates. In Ohio, they've cut tax rates. In Oklahoma, they've cut tax rates. All these Midwestern states have eased the regulatory and tax burden to make it better for business. And you know what? Look at their rankings. Don't take my look. You got all Fortune magazine, Tax Foundation. Their rankings are going way up. Then I got the Northeast. And y'all are a little better in Massachusetts. You're a little bit better. But I got New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. Connecticut used to be such a lovely place, you know. Now it's just got everything. It's got high taxes and this and that and regulations. And if they find a rivulet on your property, they throw you in the jail. I mean, it's nuts. Absolutely nuts. Connecticut, such a God. I'm only saying that because the property tax is so high, I'll never be able to sell my house and weekend house. So I'm not entirely disinterested. But I just think the low reg, low tax states have outperformed the high tax states so badly. You know, Illinois has gone the wrong way. Just California, it's funny. Jerry Brown, who I also know, and actually admire, I don't always agree with him, he's got a better economy in California despite his high taxes. So that's an interesting story. But then again, it's California. It's a little different than your average state. But, you know, he will argue, and his followers will argue, look, there's another model here, and you got a 13% top tax rate in California, and we're growing. They actually aren't growing that great. The budget deficit has come down. The growth ain't all that great. So I'll leave it there, but Texas is going to survive just fine. I mean, unless they, this guy Abbott is, I'm more conservative than Rick Perry, so Texas survived just fine. Look at Florida. Look at Georgia. Just run your thumb down the performance of these states. I just think you may not agree with my political thinking, but you just got to look at the economic numbers themselves. They really tell a story. Yes.
So you're not an inequality guy, obviously, but to the extent that the little guy thinks the system is rigged and it's unfair, your program doesn't have any chance at all. You know what I'm saying? Like, if the little guy doesn't have a trust in things, in capitalism, then the Larry Kudlow program just, it won't fly.
Well, I don't know. Has the Barack Obama program flown? Inequality has increased under Obama, and median incomes have fallen. So I ask you, how's he doing? And my program, what I would do is slash middle income taxes, right off the top. I mean, when I talk about a flat rate tax system, I would take out the 10% bracket, the 25% bracket, and the 28% bracket, which basically covers you up to about 150 grand a year. And you might go higher than that. If you want to go to 250, I mean, look, the Obama compromise, so to speak, which repealed, they only repealed Bush's top rate. Actually, you're middle class in that deal until you make something like $400,000 a year. So I would blow all that out and get what Reagan used to call take-home pay up. Just keep working, but you're going to take home more of it. That's what we need to do. We haven't done that in a while. We've done it in the past, but not for a while. Now, the rest of the story, you got to explain to me why extremely tight bank credit standards for a shop or a small business preventing loans is helpful. You got to explain to me why a lot of these regulations are helpful. I mean, look, you doing better or worse? Are people happy or unhappy? Trouble is, my guy, so Bush, made many of these mistakes. He was the starter mistaker, and Obama went further. And look, if Larry Summers were here, a very distinguished guy and a friend of mine, you know, he would disagree on some of it, but not all of it. He'd want more infrastructure spending. I can live with that, depending on how it's done. But on taxes and investment returns and capital formation and productivity, Larry would agree with me. Larry would agree with me. So I don't know that you say the Kudlow program doesn't have a chance. We're not in it now. We're not in it now. Now, you could go and blame Bush. He hadn't been president in quite a few years. But I don't really, I wouldn't blame W or praise him. I think he made some serious economic mistakes of his own. My golden years, I mean, I'll be honest with you, I'm real simple about this. The Kennedy 60s, the Reagan 80s, and then I'll call it the Clinton 90s, but I always tell President Clinton, you were Reagan's third term. Sometimes he buys that, and sometimes he doesn't. But he did a lot of stuff we wanted to do and didn't get done. I actually should be more open-minded historically. I also love the Coolidge Mellon 20s. I cannot tell a lie. One of my favorite periods of time. You should read my pal Amity Schlaes's book about Coolidge. It's a very interesting biography. So anyway, that's my response to you is we're not doing it. They do the Larry Kudlow program, let's talk in 10 years, and if it flunks and I'm still around, you can beat me up, go ahead. But you gotta give me a second chance. I want a second chance. I gave you the 80s and 90s, for Christ's sakes. You know, now you're beating me up for the last 15 years. I didn't do it. I changed my profession. I became a broadcaster. They threw me out of the economics profession. That and a few other things. So, I don't know. I'd like to give it another shot. I really would. With all respect, I understand where you're coming from. You have some.
Thank you, Larry.
Well, got in the hook.
One more.
Yes, sir. No women, ladies. I was expecting a frontal attack on my health care.
I have a question for you.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mr. Speaker. Can you comment on the Greek crisis as a potential black swan event? And the other issue I'm curious about is, what's your opinion about the high PEG ratio impacting equity prices going forward?
I don't pay much mind to it, the PEG ratio. I mean, I know it's there. There are many different of these indicators. And, you know, I look at it. I'm more of a PE guy, but it doesn't matter. They're all the piece. And what I would say to you quite simply is, regarding confidence or lack of confidence in the stock market, first of all, let me step back. I believe in stocks for the long run. Okay? I do not believe in active management. Some of my very best friends are hedge fund guys and girls, and God bless them. I just don't believe a word of it. Okay? I love them, have them on the show. I love to hear what they're thinking. They're, you know, macro is very fashionable now. But I believe in buy and hold. I really do. You might take some profits now and then, blah, blah, blah. And as you get older, you have to figure out your stock and bond. But I'm not a, I just don't play much of that game. So I'll leave that to others. Right now, the numbers on the forward basis, I don't know what the PEG is now. The PE, forward PE is about 17-something times. We're probably overdue for correction. But can I just say, I don't know anything about that. I'm more interested in the long-run trends. And it takes a lot to make me long-run pessimistic. Regarding Greece, Greece is a wonderful country that peaked in 450 BC, okay? And has basically been on a steady, long-term slide for roughly 2,500, 2,600 years, okay? Now, that's rough stuff. And the ECB is not going to change that. And the Greek socialists not going to change that. Look, here's the just really tragic part of Greece, which is a beautiful place and so forth. Greece has produced some of the great, great business people anywhere on this planet. Okay? Terrific. The trouble is, none of them live in Greece anymore. I mean, I'm being dead serious here, and I know many of them. From time to time, I've been an economic consultant. I used to have a lot of Greek clients, shippers and non-shippers, and they're in London or New York. They're not in Greece. You know why? They won't pay 100% taxes. It's easy. They don't want to have their risk of their, you know, assets confiscated. I mean, that's the problem. It isn't the Greeks. It's the government, which is usually, you know. So now, is it a systemic threat to the world economy? I say absolutely not. Absolutely not. Look, this whole thing revolves around the Chancellor of Germany. Okay, you know it and I know it. If Angela Merkel says, turn them loose, they're gone. They're gone. What's left of their banking deposit base will be gone, and it will shrivel up to nothing. All right? Now, I don't know. If you're dumb enough to own the stock of a Greek bank, you got a problem. Okay? But most people are much too smart for that. And whatever's left in Greece. You can go to the islands, they're very nice, but there's nothing. There's no there there. If she, on the other hand, continues her stand of not allowing any breakup in the Eurozone, then she will have Mr. Draghi do whatever it takes. That's the way I look at it. Real simple. I mean, I've covered this. My great friend, my wonderful friend, Michelle Caruso Cabrera, who covers this beat for CNBC, she agrees with me. She goes there periodically, and she agrees with me. It's all up to Markle, who then tells Draghi, who then does what he's going to do. My guess is, for this isn't worth anything, but my guess is they'll keep him in the system. But I'm not so sure. I'm worried more about Scotland leaving the United Kingdom, where you'll have more serious financial consequences. Greece, as I said, the age of Pericles, man, that was the peak. If you went long then, you're in deep trouble. I had one last question that somebody wanted. Yes, sir. Well, the nation, the biggest reason is the nation's split, that it's trying different experiments, hadn't found the right mix yet. I mean, that's a key thing, because the growth rate has gone down. The decline in growth and the deterioration of labor markets, just to pick a couple of indicators, has caused this bad mood. And you look at these races, not only the presidential races, but look at the turnover in Congress. You know, everybody tells me, Congress never changes because all the seats are gerrymandered. Huh? Did you take a look at whatever, 1994, but that's a long time ago, 2006, 2010, 2014? These are like major tidal wave earthquake effects, where first the House and then the Senate changed hands. So you can see people are, you know, they're rolling the dice here trying to find the right combination. Now, regards Republican marketing, you are really on to something here. Wow, look, your man, Mitt Romney, I love him, he's a man of high character, very good businessman. He was so good to me, I mean, he gave me, I think Brit Hume had more interviews, but I was second, something like that. And I'm from little teeny-weeny CNBC. So, you know, do I like the guy? Yeah. Did he run the worst campaign, arguably since Tom Dewey? Got a shot at it. I'd like to see the parallels. Who was Tom Dewey? He was declared the victor in 1948, but oops, lost to Truman. And, they, you know, had the headlines up. Anyway, yeah. You're going to self-deport all the immigrants? Well, what you got out of that was a 27% Asian as well as Hispanic vote. Asians, business people. Actually, Hispanics are too. He had a tax plan, wasn't bad. I wouldn't have done it, but he never sold it. Hardly ever talked about it. And then Team Obama, you know, just sliced him to pieces in the summer of 2012 over his private equity, you know, laying off people, ending jobs, sending them overseas. At one point, they had them killing people. Remember that one? They found some, it was false, but whatever. It's an ad that plays and people watch it. And Romney didn't have any money. He's a financial guy. They ran out of money because the convention was so late, they couldn't get the matching funds. So I mean, it's everything a man. There's awful good people in his camp. I'm not, as I say, he's a wonderful man. And of course, as you know, this is the home of Obamacare. We are here. It was called Romney Care. Now, you may like it. I don't want to debate the merits of Romney Care and Obamacare. The same guy, Gruber, was in the middle of Romney Care. I always found that quite amusing. I interviewed him several times, too. But you know your big issue in 2010, landslide, was Obamacare. I mean, he just knew that. Turns out it was probably the biggest issue in the 2014 race, too. But in 2012, the Republican Party, in its wisdom, chose the one candidate who could not argue against Obamacare because he started it. This is, that's a real wow. This is one that takes only Republican professional inside the Beltway consultants could have pulled out. You know what I mean? It's like doubling your CEO's bonus package because he or she, you know, just had their fifth year in the red. I mean, it's crazy. How'd that happen? I don't get it. The other candidates were no great shakes either. So that's why I don't want to answer the question this year, because I think you got a deep bench. Got a lot of smart, particularly the governors, but they're all smart, so it'll be more interesting. But yeah, now, last point on this. I'm going to let you go. I know you got the other fish. I just want to tell you, my part of the Kudlow philosophy, we haven't gotten to this yet. I am a big tent guy. I'm a Reagan guy. The guy who brought me into politics, who was really my mentor, was the late Jack Kemp. Okay? This goes way back to the 70s, late 70s. And, you know, not only did, you know, Jack and I agree on lower tax rates and a sound dollar, but whatever, being a New Yorker, I don't know why. The Republican Party under Reagan had plenty of room for Hispanics, for Asians, for women, for gays. You never heard Reagan go in some blast off on sexual preferences, never. I'm pro-life. I mean, I think the numbers on pro-life are actually rather favorable now by a slight amount, but that's not gonna be a big issue. The point is, the GOP, this is really, I get in heated arguments with some of my friends, some of my best, really good, dear friends, Rush Limbaugh, I've been to all his weddings, Laura Ingraham, others, Ann Coulter, I love her to death. She's a friend of my wife. They hate immigrants. What can I tell you? And I don't. And I think the evidence shows in the long run, immigrants are very good for this country and always have been. Now, we should make some changes. I get that. I'm not opposed to changes, including border security. We should emphasize skill-based immigration rather than family-based immigration. There are many changes that are constructive. Self-deportation was not one of them. Going door-to-door with policemen to root them out, that's not another. And the thing about the immigration issue is, when you make these harsh immigration statements, you're not just talking about the Mexican problem. You know who listens to those? Millennials, young people, women, particularly single women, Asians, gays. What they hear is a harsh marketing message. I don't want that. I want all of them to come. I used to represent Jack Kemp at the La Raza meetings, the Hispanic group, the liberal left group, but I wasn't even in the government. Jack was HUD secretary. He was trying to do a deal to lower the capital gains tax overall and to have what I think we call enterprise zones or empowerment zones with my friend Charlie Rangel from Harlem. You know, Charlie has a little accounting problems, but whatever. He was very good on this issue. And I used to show up at La Raza meetings. We wanted their support. I represented Kemp. And you know what? We got their support. That was great. Kemp used to go to the projects. That was great. You got to show up. Get out of your country club and go out there. And I love doing that. And that's what the Republican Party has to do. Big tent. I was so proud. I spoke last fall, before the election, to the annual dinner of the Log Cabin Republicans, who are the gay Republicans, because I had written a column, not my first. Mary Cheney got the award. She's a wonderful woman, had the same party for 20 years. I wrote a piece about this. And I said, you know what? When you talk to the Log Cabin Republicans, who I knew from New York City, they're tax cutters, deregulators, limited government, free trade, pro-business. I mean, what the hell more do you want if you're a Republican? And whatever they do about marriage, that's up to them, not me. Right. Me, I'm married 27 years, a miracle. I love my wife. Miracle. You don't know the story. It's not worth telling here. But I'm not going to, I don't control other what they do, what their preferences are. None of my business. Anyway, for all I know, their divorce rate may be lower than the heteros. Remains to be seen, okay? That's an empirical issue. So you are right, sir. The marketing has got to change. We have got to be more open and tolerant. And that goes to your point up there, because it's not all about taxes and regulations. It's about feeling. It's about an instinct in your gut. Are these guys going to help me or not? Are they for me or against me? You know, if I give Boeing, which is a great company, another authorization for $20 billion of loans from the Ex-Im Bank, which is nothing but corporate welfare, what's that do for the Main Street guy who runs a little auto and tire repair shop? The answer is nothing. Who's paying for it? He is. That's wrong. So yes, the Republicans have to wise up. I've gone on way too far. I've had great fun. I'm still going to make my train. It'll be okay. I really appreciate you. You've been just wonderful.